is. Right, we're live on Facebook. Let's see YouTube. And we might take live questions from the audience.
Yeah, sure.
All right, good. Let's put it in gallery. There we go. And let's go live here. All right.
The Radical. Fundamental principles of freedom, rational self-interest, and individual rights. This is the Yaron Brook Show.
All right, everybody. Welcome to Yaron Brook Show on this Wednesday evening. I'm excited today on today's show. First, we get to not talk about coronavirus for a whole evening, which is great. But better than that, we get to talk about a positive topic with a positive guy. So this is going to be a lot of fun. I'm joined by Dr. Andrew Bernstein. And for those of you who don't know Andy, and I'm going to call you Andy, I assume that's okay.
Yes, that's good.
It always has been. And he's got his PhD in philosophy. He has taught at many different universities, including the American University in Bulgaria, of all places. He has written four or five different books, nonfiction books on objectivism, including Objectivism in One Lesson and a couple of books on capitalism, and two novels. The latest one came out in 2017. What was the title of that, Andy?
Dearth of Eagles.
Dearth of Eagles. So two novels, four or five nonfiction books. And we're going to talk today about his latest nonfiction book, Heroes, Legends, Champions, Why Heroism Matters. And I can't think of a better time to talk about heroes. I mean, how are you doing given the insanity that we're living through right now?
Well, I mean, it is insane, and it's oppressive, and I think the government's cure is probably going to end up being worse than the disease. But all we could do is stand up for individual rights and political economic liberty. The good news is, given the social media channels available to us today, it's easier to reach people. You know, the problem is, so, you know, we have these tools at our disposal. The problem is the question, how many people really care? Yeah. You know, I mean, I see it amongst my students. It's not just that a few of, you know, some of Bernie Sanders supporters, but that, yeah, you know, the education is so bad. I'll just give you one example. I had 20 students in a college class. I won't even mention the college, just a couple of months ago. 20 out of 20 did not know, never heard of Patrick Henry.
Wow. And
10 out of 20 American kids in a college class, 10 out of 20 never heard of James Madison. I mean, I was spluttering with frustration. I said, he was the lead author of the U.S. Constitution and virtually the sole author of the Bill of Rights, and you never heard of him? That's the state of history education in the United States today. So there's very few people. We have these tools at our disposal, but there's not that many people care anymore about individual rights.
It's depressing. It is the caring. It's what I find most difficult to get motivated around is, does the audience care? Now, I know the people listening right now care, but does a broader audience, can we really expand the audience enough? But I love what I do, and I know you love what we do, and we do it out of love, and we do it for the few people who do care and whose lives
we do it for ourselves and the people we can reach. But it reminds me, you probably spoken at various Tea Party groups and everything, and you know, and no, nobody's younger than 60. I mean, you know, maybe there's one person out of 50 who's in their 50s. There's, you know, those people are Red Iron Rand. They care about the Constitution, but there's nobody, almost nobody, who's young, and it's really scary about the future of the country.
No, and the other thing about the Tea Party groups, particularly, you know, the way they've evolved is, they had a sense of life, as Ayn Rand called it. They had this spirit about them. There was no intellectual foundation for it, and that's why I think it kind of died away, because there was no there. You know, it was their love of country and their love of the Constitution was superficial in the end. But yeah, what we need are young people. What we need are people who care. What we need are people who can think.
Yeah, without a doubt. And the schools are worse and worse and worse. I'm on the front lines every day. I see it, you know, even in the good colleges. most of the kids. Many of them struggle just to read. They can't write a coherent paragraph, never mind a college level essay. They haven't taken grammar, haven't had a grammar course, so they struggle agonizingly in the logic class, and they don't know the first thing about American history. It's unbelievable. I mean, it's
how do you save America when they don't know what America means and what it represents and what?
Yeah, exactly. When you don't know who James Madison was, yeah, you know anything about the U.S. Constitution and the Bill of Rights.
Yep. So let's switch to the positive, right?
Yeah, really. Yeah.
So what drove you? What drove you to write a book about heroes and about heroism as an idea?
Well, I've been a hero worshiper since the time I was a young child, and you know, looking back on it now, without going into the gory details, I mean, I was raised in a family so dysfunctional. They put the D in dysfunctional, you know, and so I weaned myself. I realized now I weaned myself on the side of heroes. You know, my mother was severely agoraphobic. She couldn't leave the house, wouldn't leave the house. And so my favorite heroes were explorers and pioneers, you know, people like Magellan and Shackleton, yeah, and Amelia Earhart, you know, all of whom I discuss in the book. So that's one reason. You know, I've been this hero worshiper all my life. But then, you know, more theoretically, we live in a culture where heroes are either ignored or attacked. You know, it's an anti-hero mentality that dominates serious literature and film, has since World War I. And in biography and history, when you talk about the great people of history, the writers, they call it balance. You know, in the name of balance, they're committed to showing the feet of clay. Mm-hmm. And if you're a hero worshiper, they very often is considered superficial and you know, and childish. So I wanted to answer that. I want to, you know, stand up for heroes and show, you know, as a good objectivist, to show that these giants have, you know, these atlases have carried us on their shoulders for centuries, and how they deserve admiration and emulation, hero worship, properly understood, and emulation, and how that helps us. The practical achievements help us, but also the inspiration to be the best we could be helps us.
So when you were growing up, did you read a lot of kind of nonfiction? Were there a lot of heroes in the nonfiction you read?
Yeah, I was always reading hero stories, fiction or nonfiction, you know. So whether I was reading, you know, one of my favorite novels, like, you know, Jack Chaffee's Shane, or whether I was reading the biography of George Washington, you know, it was always about some hero. That's what interested me, and it's what enabled me to survive the insanity. You know, the world is pretty crazy, always has been, if you study history. And if your family's crazy on top of it, that's a double whammy for a kid.
Really is.
And so for the, you know, the heroes really helped me realize how much is possible for human beings.
So help us define what a hero is. So what is a hero? What constitutes heroism?
Well, see, it's fascinating, Yaron. This is because, you know, in the 19th century, there was this whole discussion of heroes by heavyweights, you know, Friedrich Nietzsche, however mistaken some of these guys were. These are big time guys, Nietzsche, William James, Herbert Spencer, Thomas Carlyle. They had, you know, a serious debate on what heroes were. And so I did all the research, and I was fascinated that nobody defined the concept. You know, I'm not aware. Sidney Hook, who was one of Lenin's professors at NYU, wasn't he?
Yeah. Yeah,
and Hook, I think, was a commie, a Marxist who became a neoconservative.
Really?
Yeah, and you know, wrote a book, The Hero in History. I just think of it as the Hook book, you know. And it's an interesting book. There's a lot of interesting things in this discussion, but there's no definitions. Now, you know, I thought about that. You know, Hook's a philosopher. Nietzsche's a philosopher. William James, the psychologist, became a philosopher. They must know the history of moral philosophy. They know Socrates' enterprise, you know, of seeking, you know, rigorous definitions for these important moral philosophic concepts. I mean, all of Plato's dialogues are, you know, what is justice? What is, you know, virtue? What is knowledge? And then no attempt at definition. So this is what I wanted, one of the things I wanted to do. Because I had the advantage of reading Ayn Rand, and you know, I knew, you know, that man's life is the standard of moral value, and I knew that we form concepts by a process of integration and differentiation. That's where I started out the book. So I think the first thing we need to know about heroes, you know, that colloquially they're good guys, and good guys in the objectivist sense, of course, means they promote human life, they take action in service of human life. you know, Shane's a gunfighter, but he's not, you know, he's not hired out to the bad guys to fight the good guys. He's working for the good guys against the bad. Yeah, he's a good guys. And I think the heroes, of course, you know, so they take action in promotion of human life. And the epic heroes, who I think were the first instances upon which we formed the concept, have prowess or ability, you know, above and beyond that of every man and every woman, whether, you know, it's Aristotle's genius or, you know, what Ernest Shackleton accomplished, you know, and that survival story, his leadership skills, his mental and bodily toughness. I mean, these are characteristics that are off the charts, so prowess above and beyond, you know, that of every man and every woman. And then is, I think, an important, you know, courage is the salient characteristic of a hero, as is often pointed out. But I think it's broader than that. I think of it as dauntlessness, because it doesn't necessarily take courage to do, say, what Edison did, to work and work to resolve some intractable problem and invent the electric light. It takes perseverance. It takes dauntlessness. You know, you're not dismayed in the face of terrible obstacles and or dangers and or opposition. And by the way, I wanted to combat the idea that heroes are fearless, because I think that's irrational. To be fearless is irrational. Absolutely. I mean, if somebody shoots machine guns at you on, you know, at Guadalcanal or whatever it is, and you're not afraid, you can't value, you're either crazy or you can't value your life very much, right? Yeah. Or both. But heroes are dauntless. They may be afraid, but they know what's the right thing to do, and they stand up for it, even if they're afraid. And I think the fourth characteristic is they achieve victory in some sense, even if it's only a moral sense. And Cyrano is a great fictional example. Every one of his practical goals is defeated for one reason or another, but he's so dauntless in standing up for what he knows is right. He won't kiss up to the cardinal to get his plays performed. He says he's committed to what he knows is right. And that's an undying greatness in him that inspires us to this day. So I think those are the characteristics of heroes. Action and promotion of human life, prowess above and beyond that of every man and every woman, dauntlessness in the face of intense obstacles and or antagonism, and victory in at least a moral sense. I think those are the four characteristics of the hero.
And the dauntlessness is what you call the kind of the character, the having a heroic character.
It's commitment to what you know is right, even in the it may take a form of endless perseverance, and I think Edison is a good example. It may take the form of, you know, of great courage. You know, like a lot of heroes have stood up for liberty against Nazis or communists or jihadists, you know, and risk their lives, or both. But it's dauntlessness in the face of intense opposition and or dangerous antagonism that's what characterizes a hero. It's really, in objectivist terms, it's a commitment. It's an undying commitment to life enhancing values.
So here's a question that is right out of a chapter of your book. So it's perfect. Some try to invalidate heroes. This is one of the questions from one of the live listeners. Some try to invalidate heroes by emphasizing their flaws, such as Steve Jobs allegedly being mean to his employees. Why is that wrong? Somebody threw that at me that, you know, Steve Jobs yelled at his employees. I said something like, I would give so much to be able to travel back in time to be an employee of Steve Jobs so he could yell at me just once. Really?
Well, Leonard Peikoff said the same about Ayn Rand, didn't he?
Yeah, absolutely.
She yelled, lose her temper and yell at
the issue of flawed heroes, the fact that heroes can be heroes, even though in some other aspect of their life they might be flawed. You have a chapter on this in the book, right?
Yes, I sure do. And I use Thomas Jefferson as the main example in that chapter. But let me start off with the Jobs example. Because, you know, that recent movie, Steve Jobs, a couple of years ago with Michael Fassbender, you know, Magneto, as Steve Jobs, was fascinating because, you know, I don't know, 40, slightly less than 50% maybe was devoted to how messy Jobs' personal life was. And you know, he denied paternity and all this. But I think slightly more than 50%, what I loved about it, showed this Howard Raw kind of visionary entrepreneur who had a vision of what computers could be, and by God, he was going to achieve it no matter what, and he did, and it was great. And you're right, a lot of people stayed at Apple, even though Steve Jobs maybe was this personal, you know, he was this verbally abusive guy. I guess, like, you know, my Rag Regina said, you know, well, their 401k didn't hurt, but which is true, but these were talented people who could have worked anywhere. I think they stayed at Apple because they knew that Steve Jobs would get the best out of them.
And to be around a genius and to be around somebody who was changing the world, I mean, literally changing the world in his actions. I mean, the satisfaction for being a part of something like that must be immense.
Yeah, must be. You're absolutely right. I think that's why, what, you know, Leonard Peikoff said, you know, Ayn Rand, she wouldn't understand. She would be frustrated with him and she'd yell at him, but he was around the greatest literary philosophic genius in the world and learning from this mind. But anyway, to answer your question, I use Thomas Jefferson as an example. The dishonest things about Jefferson, according to American historians like Joseph Ellis, are much more egregious than anything Steve Jobs is accused of. I mean, one, you know, in the 1790s, when he was part of the Washington administration, evidently he spread rumors that President Washington was senile. He hired a scandalmonger to write a venomous screed against President Adams, who was his personal friend and longtime revolutionary ally, then denied culpability of it. Joseph Ellis put it beautifully when he said Jefferson conducted this artful minuet with duplicity. You know, so I mean, he was dishonest in some ways. Plus, I mean, he was a lifelong abolitionist who never freed, you know, individualist and abolitionist who never freed his slaves even when he died. And very likely had a love affair long-term with Sally Hemings. Never freed his lover. I mean, this is not the stuff of which heroes are made. And yet, you know, the positive side of the ledger is just, you know, immense, right? I mean, early commitment to freedom from Great Britain, brilliant pro-stylist, lead author of the Declaration of Independence, you know, fervent supporter of religious freedom, staunch supporter of, you know, independent thinking, and swore eternal opposition to any form of tyranny over the mind of man. Established University of Virginia, you put his personal book collection, you know, to start the Library of Congress. I mean, his achievements, you know, are so immense. And I think in a case like this, what we have to do is, first of all, we know that human beings have the capacity of selective focus, and we could abstract away from various issues. I think we're objectivists, right? At least you and I are. You know, probably a lot of listeners are. So we take the John Galt approach. We look reality in the face, even if it's ugly. And we say, wow, Thomas Jefferson, I have great admiration for you, but that is just wrong. You know, you're just, it's morally wrong. It's morally flawed. And so we don't deny, you know, the moral turpitude here. We face it, we acknowledge it, we censure it, we deplore it. And then we abstract away from it because in human life, if life's the standard of value, not death, that's not the standard of value, life's the standard of value, then that which promotes life is the most important. And Jefferson, in the pro-life, life-supporting actions he took as a towering hero in the cause of personal liberty. Absolutely. So he's a mixed case. I think he's a hero, but he's a morally flawed hero.
Yep. And so can anybody be a hero? Is hero available to the common man?
That's a fascinating question. And I agree with Ayn Rand. In fact, it's hard for me to think of any, you know, philosophic issues where I don't.
Yeah.
You know, maybe some applied topical things about women present or things like that. But, you know, on moral philosophic issues, I agree with Ayn Rand. She said, you know, hero is in the human potential. And I think that's true. And I think, you know, every man and every woman, Maybe we will lack the prowess or the capacity of, you know, the epic hero. You know, I don't have Aristotle's genius or Ayn Rand's writing abilities or, you know, or Michael Jordan's athleticism or, you know, or things like that. But I have some degree of ability, and practice makes perfect. I can work at it and get better and better. And of course, the main thing is, the characteristic of the heroic characteristic open to all of us is the dauntlessness, the undismayed attitude, the willingness to face any opposition or antagonism in support of our values. And you'll see people do this. I have the example of that woman in Britain, Ellen MacDonald, who triumphed over cancer five different times. And that's with the National Health Service, right? You know, she triumphed over cancer five different times. She was given the last rites by a priest, I don't know, 40 or 50 years before she celebrated her 100th birthday. Now, you know, she may not be a genius like Aristotle or Ayn Rand, but I mean, this is heroism in service of a, you know, of life itself. This is a tremendous achievement. It takes great courage, you know, and she told the priest she survived. She said, because I'm a fighter. And yeah, that's she's a hero.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So people associate heroism in the culture with self-sacrifice. I mean, almost all the heroes we hear about in the popular culture associate with some kind of sacrificial action. Why is that wrong? Why is that incompatible with heroism?
Yeah, that's one of the main polemical points. You know, when you asked before why I wrote the book, one of the main polemical points I wanted to address is that conventional belief that heroes are self-sacrificing. And, you know, it comes from the conventional misunderstanding of morality. And I again, it's a great advantage to live post Ayn Rand and to have objectivism, you know, an Atlas Shrugged available. And then I can point out, heroes take action in promotion of values. Values are the meaning of life. Values are what make life possible. They're the means of life, and they're the meaning of life. And so if some great hero risks his life defending the freedom of the United States, his own freedom, the freedom of the family he loves, the freedom of the country he loves against the Nazis or some, you know, nefarious enemy like that, his actions are value laden. They're in service of liberty and, you know, of a tremendous value, and so on and so forth. Heroes are valuers, and they stand up for value. You know, and I think the what Ayn Rand showed us here morally, and I think Ayn Rand is the greatest moral philosopher of history. I do. But she's two things. One, your legitimate value is objectively life promoting. And, you know, like education or your a productive career or, you know, romantic love with a man or woman who's morally, you know, upright and trustworthy. And then two, personally cherished by the value. You put those two together, the person cherishes a value X, which in fact is life promoting, you know, like liberty, and you're fighting against the Nazis or the communists or the jihadists or whatever, you know, and you're taking action in service of your values. This is the definition of selfishness. You're taking action in service of values, no matter the dangers. And so, you know, the truth is the polar opposite of the conventional view. Heroes are not selfless. Rather, they're selfish. And Ayn Rand says their actions are always value driven.
So if you're fighting for a bad cause and you do so valiantly, or valiantly is the wrong word, if you do so in spite of the risks and everything, would you not consider that person a hero?
That's correct. I would not. And one of the great examples, I think, although I didn't mention him in the book, but was a guy named Otto Skorzeny, who was a Nazi. He was a German commando in World War II. He was SS, and these SS guys were hardcore Nazis. You know, I mean, they were the master race, you know, and we're going to subjugate, enslave, and or annihilate the inferior races and so on and so on. You know, and I point out, heroes take action in promotion of human life. They don't take action in promotion of mass murder. So no matter the daring do of a Nazi commando like that, he's not a hero. You know, he's a tough guy. I mean, he's a formidable enemy, but that makes him a dangerous villain. You know, he's taking action in service of a totalitarian state perpetrating mass murder. There's no virtue in that, and there's no heroism in it.
Yep. What do you think of, it's not in the book, at least I don't think so. What do you think of superheroes?
I love superheroes.
You do?
Yeah. My only lament is that, see, it's interesting.
That you're not one?
No, wouldn't that be nice? You know, a friend of mine who's a, not an objectivist, but an Ayn Rand fan, he pointed out very nicely. He said, this is the real superpower.
Yes.
You know, our intelligence. And that's a good point. Yep. This is the real superpower. So in a way we are, if we, you know, if we harness it effectively enough. But I love superheroes. I was always more of a Marvel guy, you know, than a DC guy. I love the Avengers and everything. I go to all the superhero movies and everything. And there's the good news and the bad news, right? I mean, the good news is their popularity at the level of popular culture shows that a lot of people are starved, you know, for the sight of heroes. The bad news is the so-called serious writers, you know, they're not, you know, their stories aren't, for more than 100 years now, their stories have generally not been about heroes, but about these poor schlubs who are, you know, overcome with ennui, or they have alcohol or drug problems, or they're dominated by dysfunctional families. And, you know, it's the anti-hero mentality still dominates for 100 years since World War I, serious literature and film. And it's that's sad.
Yeah, I mean, I have to say, I'm not a big fan of most superheroes. I've just got tired of the repetitiveness, and it's sad to me that we have to have superheroes rather than just heroes, right? We need to embed them with some superpower for them to be heroic. You're right. There's almost no movies where we just have a good hero, particularly not heroes that use this, right? The heroes of the mind. You don't see that in the culture. So all we have are the superheroes who are primarily heroes of the physical action.
Yeah, and there's the good news and the bad news. That reminds me, I don't know, 5 or 6 years ago, the Michael Keaton film Birdman, you know, which won Best Picture. Yeah. Yeah. I enjoyed that movie. I thought it was, you know, I got a kick out of it because, you know, part of it was this contrast between popular culture and so-called serious culture. I mean, he was a movie star, right? Playing a superhero character. And he wants to get into serious roles. So what does he do? He takes a Raymond Carver story. Raymond Carver, your audience probably knows something. I mean, he writes about drug addicts and alcoholics and people whose married lives are crushed. And it's just, he just writes about people who are just, their lives are just crushed, you know? And so the contrast between, you know, popular culture and serious culture, and I thought popular culture came out ahead on points by the end of the movie. So I enjoyed that.
Yeah, not much of a fair competition.
but you're right. That was around the same time, around 5 or 6 years ago. I wrote an essay on this, that there was a little mini renaissance in film for a while about heroes and heroes of the mind. That's when the Steve Jobs movie came out and really depicted him as the visionary genius he was. Yep. And Spielberg's movie Bridge of Spies was out.
Yep.
Then, you know, about, you know, the American lawyer, you know, hero, and who's just a really virtuous person. And that terribly misnamed movie, Most Violent Year, with Oscar Isaac and Jessica Chastain.
Really a good movie. Right?
It was a great movie. It's like Howard Roark in the fuel oil industry.
I know, I didn't expect it at all. It was a pro-businessman, pro-profit even, and a hero, a real hero.
Yeah, committed to virtue. Yeah, I mean, he's really committed. I mean, his father-in-law was a gangster. His wife was a gangster's daughter. He got the business from the gangster, and yet he was committed to doing this virtuously. It was a great movie. It shouldn't have been named The Most Violent Year. It should have been named The Most Upright Man, you know, and there was this flurry of serious hero movies around 2015. That's when Whiplash came out, you know, and what was the name of that movie about Alan Turing and the development of
That was excellent. That was
the
excellent
development of the first computer to crack the German Enigma code. The name will come to me, but that was a flurry of movies about real serious heroes, and it just unfortunately didn't last.
No, the culture doesn't allow it, unfortunately. The serious culture won't allow it, because all those movies did fairly well in theater. It's not that they were rejected by the population. They were rejected by the critics and intellectuals.
Yes.
Oh, The Imitation Game. The Imitation Game.
Yeah, The Imitation Game, exactly. Yeah,
Thank you, Emiliano. On the chat.
That's
here.
Right, with Benedict Cumberbatch, right?
I love. He's a good actor. He just played Edison in the Commodore. was.
Yeah, that was a good movie too. The current one. Yeah, that was excellent. Again, you know, it showed Edison's flaws and his errors, but at the same time, it had reverence for his genius.
And I didn't know much about Westinghouse. And it was really, really inspiring. I mean, he was quite a character. He was a real amazing entrepreneur.
Yeah, he was. Westinghouse became, you know, there's a section of this in the Capitalist Manifesto, by the way. Westinghouse became rich, like he was like 21 years old. He's the guy who designed the air brakes to stop freight trains, you know? And he was a brilliant entrepreneur. And there's a great scene in the movie where, you know, Westinghouse is talking to his tech guy and saying, you know, we got to figure out, you know, a way to do this. And the tech guy says, it can't be done. And Westinghouse says, how do you know that? And the tech guy says, if it could be done, Edison would have done it already. You know, and it showed such reverence for Edison's genius, even while, you know, showing his legitimate flaws.
Yep. Yeah. No, that was excellent. Did you see Ford versus Ferrari?
I did. Yeah, I did.
That was good.
Yeah, it was. It was. And you know, Carroll Shelby was a real, you know, he was a brilliant auto designer, with, you know, without a doubt. But there are real heroes in our in our society. But since we're not on a hero worshiping premise, at least the intellectuals aren't. We don't hear about them. And perfect example of that was Maurice Hillman, you know, who most people never heard of. But given all the furor over vaccines these days, he was a brilliant vaccinologist at Merck. He and his team, you know, designed 8 of the 14 leading vaccines that are routinely prescribed for mumps and measles and hepatitis A. When he died in 2005, that's when I first heard of him, Yaron, from the obituaries. You know, and I'm not, you know, generally reading the obituary pages. This guy's a towering hero in the field of medicine. Another medical giant, I think it was Robert Gallo, the guy who discovered the AIDS virus. Yeah. Gallo said publicly that Hillman's work saved more lives than that of any medical researcher of the 20th century.
Wow.
And we never heard of him. Never heard of the guy.
No, and I think that probably people every day in biotech and technology and industry and places that are doing heroic things, but we're geared, the whole news cycle, everything about our culture is geared towards the negative. It's geared towards the bad news. It's geared toward fear. And so we don't hear about them. You know, there's nobody is reporting about the good news.
If it bleeds, it leads, right? Isn't that what they teach in J school?
I guess. Luckily didn't take any classes there.
I hear, but it's true. You think about it. So there's all this bad stuff that goes on in the world, you know, every day. You know, Trump, you know, restrict free trade, or the Democrats want to push us into socialism, or there's a civil war somewhere that killed, you know, 80,000 innocent victims. You know, and that's always on the news. And okay, it's important. It should be. But at the same time, you're right. Somebody is working on, you know, a vaccine for coronavirus. Somebody's working on, you know, cures for cancer. Somebody's composing, you know, beautiful music somewhere, writing a great novel. This should be top news also.
Absolutely. You know? Absolutely. In a different culture, it would be. There would be a whole section about and commemorating some of these giants. That's the other thing is, we, you know, all these anniversaries, almost every day is somebody's birthday, some genius of the past birthday. And we don't celebrate the giants on whose shoulders we stand.
You know, it's true. We have a holiday, the Labor Day. You know, all right, Labor Day. I mean, I'll take any holiday I could get. And most workers are honest guys. I mean, the labor leaders probably still tend to be Marxists, but most, you know, rank and file, they're honest, you know, working guys. But in the United States, we don't have a holiday for Entrepreneurs Day. I mean, we don't have a national holiday for Inventors Day. I mean, we should celebrate Edison's birthday as Inventors Day and celebrate all the great inventors, innovators, and entrepreneurs who raise the American living standards, what it is. And we don't. That's really sick. Labor Day, but not Entrepreneurs Day?
Rockefeller's birthday is another example.
Yeah, sure. Or Carnegie's.
Yep.
Or the Wright brothers, both of them, or one of them.
Yeah, I mean, there's inventors, the entrepreneurs, I mean, the businessmen. I mean, there's a whole gamut of different categories of people who have been the greatest beneficiaries of mankind. And they excel at different things. You know, Edison excelled at invention. Other people excelled at taking those inventions and making them into businesses that allowed all of us to benefit from them. I mean, there's so many of them, and it's as Ayn Rand described. I mean, they are the most underappreciated class of human beings ever. Is the great businessman?
Yeah, absolutely right, and in some cases, even by the so-called conservatives who claim to support capitalism. I mean, I'm flabbergasted when I see some of these guys fear productivity in other nations, where they fear productivity, and free trade. And they'll say, productivity in one, I heard one conservative site, I can't remember his name offhand, productivity in China or some other country won't benefit us or won't benefit other countries. And I'm like, wait a minute. Wait, hold on a second. Time out. I mean, I know they don't teach American history anymore, but just as one example, I mean, you think Henry Ford's mass production of the automobile didn't benefit people in other countries, or the Wright brothers' invention of the airplane, or Edison's invention of the electric light, or Jobs and Wozniak, with Apple One and then the Mac and everything? You don't think American productivity hasn't benefited people all over the world? I mean, that's just wrong. I mean, that's just, and Japanese productivity has been immensely beneficial, and so would China if they didn't have that communist regime that's just evil.
Yeah, and could Ford have done what he'd done if not for the Germans inventing kind of the automobile and really getting things rolling? I mean, it's all the idea of a zero-sum world, the idea that somebody else's wealth is at our expense, and that somehow a national border is what, makes it a zero-sum game or a zero-positive game is just absurd. Trade works well within America. It just doesn't work well outside America. I mean, that's nuts.
Yeah, after people read, well, first of all, a lot of people need to learn how to read. I'm sad to say, because there's still the people who can control the schools of education and teachers' colleges still opposed to phonics. They still want to use some variation on the word method. So a lot of the kids, college kids, can't read. So that's the first thing. But after we teach these people how to read, one, they need to read Ayn Rand, and then two, on this issue, all they need to do is read Bastiat. I mean, Bastiat is so brilliant on free trade and the benefits of it that and do it humorously and very, very clearly, so you enjoy it.
So a couple of things back to heroes. So yeah, you have a chapter on anti-heroes, which is kind of what we have today, right? I mean, most of our movies have some kind of anti-hero. So how do you define an anti-hero? And do you have an example of an anti-hero in popular movies or literature?
Yeah, anti-heroes, it's a misnomer. It makes it sound like they're anti the heroes, like they're opposed to heroes. Yep. But villains are opposed to heroes. Anti-heroes are just feckless. They're hapless. They're weak characters. They're people, we were discussing them before. They're easily overcome by in the Marxist view, by the booted heel of the capitalist system, or by their dysfunctional families. And a serious 20th century literature is just permeated with it. I mean, Willie Loman, off the top of my head, from Arthur Miller's Death of a Salesman, is a guy who's, and Miller's coming from a quasi-Marxist position. Willie's been seduced by the capitalist dream, the self-made man, the Horatio Alger story he's trying. He's pursuing this elusive, unattainable dream, and eventually he's crushed by it. That's John Steinbeck's, the Dust Bowl novels,
mm-hmm. Yep.
Rapes of Wrath, and of Mice and Men. They're perfect examples. And I had that great quote from Faulkner, and Faulkner writes about Faulkner's interesting case, because I think on the one hand, he's a powerful writer. I mean, but he's writing about psychopaths, and just sick people. But he says, it was one of the quotes from In the Sound and the Fury, one of the leading characters, "I give you the mausoleum of all hope." The mausoleum of hope. I mean, yeah, there's a good 20th century credo. It's hopeless. And poor Gatsby and F. Scott Fitzgerald's the great guy. He's great, but he's crushed. And he's pursuing the elusive dream. And you see in some of these cases, Gatsby, Willie Loman, man is condemned to aspire, but the aspirations are forever unattainable, and they're crushed in the attempt to reach them. So, I mean, 20th century literature is permeated by the sad spectacle of people who cannot achieve their values. They're just too weak, or the problems are too powerful, or both.
Yeah. What do you think about movies, and I'm sure it's in literature, but I know it more from movies, where there's clearly a hero, but he's miserable, right? He's divorced, and he has no fun, and he gets no girls, and he has no, you know, there's nothing, but he does the right thing, and he's committed to it. And then the villain, who's clearly a villain, he's the bad guy. He has the girls, and he has the money, and he has the, and this is like a theme. It you know, even in superheroes like Spider-Man, right? He can't get the girl. The heroism, the fact that he's a hero prevents him from getting the girl, you know, because in a sense he has to, he's protecting her or whatever. But they always make the hero suffer. They always make the hero, you know, brooding and miserable versus the happy villain.
Yeah. It's like, what does Mayor Bascom tell Dagny in Atlas? What does he say? In this world, lady, you're either good or you're happy, right? Wasn't that the line?
Rand had a line for all of everything.
Yeah, she did. And Reardon wanted to punch him in the head because, you know, he recognized the, you know, what did he tell her? Get an imitation engagement ring or something. But you're right. There's Kant's influence, at least in part. I mean, it probably goes back further than that. But Kant's influence that...
Oh, Christianity may be original sin.
Yeah. And Kant codified it into a formal moral theory, because much as I hate to say it, Kant is one of the great moral philosophers of history in terms of his influence. You know, to Kant, we could be virtuous or we could be happy, but we can't be both. And I think the serious intellectual world is permeated by German philosophy, which is why I think they're even worse than the religious conservatives, because, I mean, Kant, Hegel, and Marx, what I think of as the unholy triumvirate. You know, what they stand for is the dominance of society over the individual in different forms. And of course, politically, that means, you know, National Socialism and, you know, and communism. But let me give a perfect example of what you would think, because I'm writing a series of hard-boiled detective novel love stories. Okay. You know, the hero's name is Tony Just. He's a he changed his name to Anthony Justice when he was 18. He's a philosophy professor at Brooklyn College. He's a private eye part-time. The stories are filled with these robustly colorful Brooklyn characters. He's deeply in love with Lisa Flowers, who's a psychologist. You know, but she's married. And anyway, you know, I have, these are the next books I'm going to publish, and discerning readers will see Tony Just and Lisa Flowers are the hottest couple in detective fiction, and the sex scenes are great, if I say so myself. But so, you know, but I enjoy all these hard-boiled detective novels. Sure. You know, Raymond Chandler, for instance, sure. Philip Marlowe series. You know, or John McDonald, Travis McGee, or Robert Parker in the Spencer series. And here, a perfect example of your point is Philip Marlowe. You know, in Raymond Chandler's books, and these are great stories. Everything in LA is corrupt, and everybody's dirty, and nobody's clean, and everybody's got an angle. But Philip Marlowe's like a knight in shining armor. He's a man of great integrity. He does good. You know, he's tremendously competent. But Yaron, he's always alone. He doesn't even have a friend, much less a lover. You know, and he's always alone. And you know, and you're right. And I think there's that Kantian dichotomy, and Mayor Bascom puts it at the popular level. In this world, lady, you know, you're good or you're happy. But what do you say? Not both, lady. Not both, he tells her.
It's tragic. I mean, you know, growing up, imagine growing up with that idea. You can be good or you can be happy. I mean, it's just, it's a devastating idea psychologically. It's just horrific.
Yeah. Yeah, it absolutely is. And again, you could see Ayn Rand's point about Kant's influence in modern culture. And I think you're certainly right. He's cashed in on 2,000 years of Christianity. But still, the intellectuals generally tend to be secular and atheistic. The influence on them is German philosophy, you know, not religion.
Not directly Christianity.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
So this is one of the super chat questions. How does being inspired by heroes help an individual's life?
Well, I think, you know, one of my favorite examples is Ernest Shackleton, you know, who, I mean, the readers can read that section at the start of the book, but they can read Alfred Lansing's book, Endurance. The story is just almost unbelievable. It's like you couldn't make it up. You know, they want to traverse the Antarctic landmass. The ship got crushed in ice. They're thousands of miles, hundreds of miles from the nearest inhabited whaling station across raging seas in the Antarctic. You know, it's cold and it's brutal. It's 50-foot waves. They got a little boat. They make it like 800 miles to South Georgia Island. The boat's all this. That was the trial by water. The boat's all beat up. Now they got to climb these towering mountain peaks. Nobody's ever climbed them before. They have 5,000 or 6,000 feet, no coverage. They're not mountaineers to start with. They have no equipment between the three of them. They have like a line of rope and an axe, literally. And they do us unbelievable. I mean, it's the greatest survival story in history. And so, you know, when somebody reads that story and, you know, and then they're confronted with some, you know, some obstacles or dangers in their own life, you know, like some very courageous people battling cancer or some serious ailment. And they have their favorite hero. It could be Shackleton, or it could be George Washington at Valley Forge or whatever. And then the inspiration is, well, if they could face those kinds of daunting challenges and dangers with the kind of sublime courage they did, by God, so can I. I could take on cancer, you know, in the same way and fight for my values the way they did. And that kind of inspiration gives us courage to face the obstacles and dangers in our own life.
Absolutely. So before I've got a bunch of questions that are not related to heroism that people want to ask you, but so before we get, where can people get the book? I mean, I've put a link on Amazon to the book. Anything else you want to say about the book, or you want to, there it is.
Here it is. Heroes, Legends, Champions, Why Heroism Matters. Well, Amazon's a great company, right? And Jeff Bezos is another hero, although I hear he's also verbally abusive, but that's okay. I mean, he's a real hero. Great, Amazon's a great company. They sell all books you could get. Certainly get best place to get it is on Amazon. And I think for anybody who cares about heroes, I think they're going to get a lot out of the book.
And I put a link to the Amazon page in the description below, so any of you can find it down there. So here's some questions. A couple of them are personal, so you decide if you want to answer them. Andrew, how are you able to develop such a positive, benevolent sense of life, having come from an abusive and dysfunctional family? And connected to that is, have you cut contact from your family since achieving the self-esteem from integrating objectivist ideas?
No, I'll answer those questions. I got, you know, without getting too personal and I'm boring you with the details, you know, a lot of people know me publicly as a writer and a lecturer and everything, and they know I have a very ebullient personality. And they may not realize that, you know, I struggle every day with depression, you know, from coming out of this crazy family. And you live in a crazy world. I mean, you see what goes on in the world, and it is objectively enough to, you know, to depress people. I mean, just one example, going back 25 years, off the top of my head, was the Rwandan massacre. And they chopped up like 800,000 people, largely with machetes. I mean, these are human beings, you know. I mean, I struggle with depression. The feeling is, in this world, what's the use? And I find that the best, you know, and I've spent a lot of time in psychotherapy, and it helps with a good, you know, shrink. But the best antidote for depression is values. Your values, you know, something to live for, something that you're passionate about, something that gives you like meaning. So I fight depression, you know, with values, and even though these problems from my family, you know, I still have had a lot of joy and meaning in my life. And the second part is, I mean, my parents are gone. If they were still alive, I think I would still have contact with them. I have a beautiful 17-year-old daughter, you know, adopted from China. My mother, crazy as she was, legitimately loved children. So I wouldn't have, you know, deprived either of them of, you know, contact with each other. I think she would have been, no question, she would have been very loving to Penny, and Penny would have gotten a lot out of it. So, and I'm very close to my sister, who's a really good person, came out of the same craziness. And, you know, we could talk about it because we had the same, you know, insane family. So yeah, that, I mean, that's the short answer.
Yep. Somebody asked, whoops, what did I do there? Was the mafia big when you were growing up in Brooklyn? Did you ever look up to some of those guys as heroes? Which part of Brooklyn did you grow up in?
If you know Brooklyn, I went to high school at James Madison, which is, you know, near King's Highway. Is, you know, it's not that far from the Sheepshead Bay area of Brooklyn. Yeah, the mafia was big in New York. As John Gotti was the Teflon Don back then. And emphatically, no, I never looked up to mobsters. I remember not liking The Godfather. I was the only person I knew didn't like The Godfather movie. I could see maybe it was well done, but I, you know, these movies that glorify gangsters don't do it for me. I mean, if you have a hero who takes out the gangsters, you know, who fights them and defeats them, then I, you know, I like that. But gangsters are really bad people. I mean, they may not be as bad as Hitler, Stalin, or Mao, but that's damning them with faint praise, right? So no, I never liked mafioso or other gangsters. You'll see when my hard-boiled detective novel love stories come out, the drug cartel, you know, bad guys in one, and various gangsters in the second one. But, you know, the good guys overcome them. So, I mean, that's that part of it I like. But for me to like it, it's got to have a hero, not just villains.
Yep, I agree. Did Rand ever comment on comic book heroes? What do you guys think of modern comic book heroes? I guess the Avengers.
I don't know of any comments.
Well, I mean, do you remember the story?
Fountainhead comic strip. Huh?
In the Romantic Manifesto, there's, what's it, the moral betrayal, the moral treason, where she describes the story of this guy she knows who wanted to admire heroes, and his parents would crush that in him and slowly just crush that spirit from him. So she talks somewhere about comic book heroes as being like an introduction to heroism for young kids and something to be inspired by. So she had a positive view of them for kids.
Yeah, I didn't even remember that. So that's good to know. And she wrote a comic strip version of The Fountainhead, right? On with Howard Roark as the hero. But I think, you know, that makes a lot of sense that, you know, comic book heroes are really good for kids. You know, and other children's books that have heroes. I like Peter Pan, for example. That as an introduction to heroes for kids, and then they could graduate to more serious stories about heroes later. But the comic book heroes today, I'm not that familiar with them. I just see them on the newsstand sometimes. They look pretty dark to me. You know, at some point, the comic book heroes went from being rather benign. There was a lot of violence, but, you know, the good guy would beat up the bad guy and send them off to jail in the end. Was, you know, a little bit later, after I'd already, you know, left reading comic books, I got the impression that sometimes it's fight to the death, you know, and these guys get killed, you know, in bloody battles. I don't know. I don't, that, to me, that's not the best way to introduce kids to heroes, but they seem to have gotten pretty dark, but I'm not sure about that because I haven't read them in a while.
So I love that you bring up Shane in the book. Shane is an amazing story. It's so, and actually the book, I think, is quite, the movie's really good, but the book is much better.
Yeah, I agree.
The book is spectacular. So I would recommend everybody read Shane. What is it about Shane that you love so much?
Oh, there's a couple of things. First of all, I think what Shane is really about is hero worship, you know, and the value of hero worship in human life. And I think it's as good, if not the best thing ever written on hero worship. And I give, you know, a lot of credit to Jack Schaefer. But Bobby Starrett, you know, hero worship Shane, and, you know, Shane wants him to hear, doesn't want to hero worship a gunfighter, wants him to hero worship his productive father, who's like an Ayn Rand hero. He's an innovator, and he's, you know, a man of peace and productivity. The book is all about the enormous value of hero worship for the child growing up, whether he hero worships either of these two heroes, either or both. He's going to get tremendous value in his life. That's one thing I love about Jack Schaefer's novel. And then the other thing is just the benevolence, the sheer goodwill, you know, that permeates the way Shane loves the whole family, you know, and he gives up a lot, but, you know, because he's given up his quest for a peaceful life, but he cannot let Joe Starrett be murdered, Marion be widowed, and Bobby be semi-orphaned. It's one of the most benevolent stories that I've ever read in my life. It's just goodwill just permeates the story, and it's beautiful. It's absolutely beautiful.
Yeah, I encourage, if you guys have not read the novel, Shane, I encourage you to do that, and definitely watch the movie too, because the movie's quite good. I think it's a good representation of the novel. Let's see, we got two more questions. How come Aristotle had flaws and contradictions in his philosophy while Ayn Rand did not? Didn't they both use the same method?
Yeah, but 2,500 years apart. For one thing, Aristotle's dates are 384 BC to 322 BC, your 4th century BC. It's not even a, I don't think it's a stretch to say he's not living in the context of knowledge so much as he's living in the context of ignorance. You know, very little was known about anything. Aristotle may well be, I think we could say intellectually, he's the greatest pioneer of human history. I mean, he's the first great biologist that we know of. He's the first great logician that we know of. He's the greatest metaphysician in history. He's one of the great moral philosophers in history, in a field that didn't even particularly fascinate him as much as these other more technical fields. So, when you're a pioneer, and Aristotle is often criticized for all these errors he made in physics. So, okay, he made a lot of errors in physics. He's also, I think he was right about certain things, given my limited knowledge. But in the 4th century BC, were you supposed to be surprised by that? You got to grant somebody their historical context. Pioneers make errors. They almost by definition, they're moving into fields that are uncharted. You know, they're the first guy there. And so I think we could point out honestly Aristotle's errors and then okay, fine, and then glorify the enormity of his achievements. And the second point here is Ayn Rand was the first to acknowledge she's building on Aristotle, you know, how much she learned from Aristotle. You know, but overwhelmingly in a positive way, and then in some ways in a negative way too, to avoid his errors. So we stand on the shoulders of giants. Wasn't that Newton's line? And Ayn Rand first to acknowledge he's standing on Aristotle's shoulders.
And the fact that you use the right method doesn't mean you're going to be right all the time.
Yeah, good point.
Mistakes.
It means you have a self-correcting mechanism, yeah. But you're still fallible beings.
Absolutely. Let's see. So we got two more. Are the ideas of enlightenment stronger in the culture of New York or California?
Oh, Jesus. Well, let's see. We got these two leftist cesspools. And that's enlightenment. The New York and California, you know, Massachusetts, these so-called blue states, I don't even want to characterize them as leftist because that's limiting ourselves to politics, which is, we know, is superficial. Yep. It's modernist philosophy. It's the German philosophy that dominates. And it's really enough to make me throw up many times because, you know, the so-called intellectual elites, you know, look down on the ignorant, you know, non-college educated working man in Ohio or whatever. They went to college. You know, in a lot of, you know, a lot of people in the so-called blue states, but what they studied in the humanities was the legacy of German philosophy. They've been studying Kant, Hegel, and Marx. They've been studying postmodernism. You know, they have this idea that, you know, there's different racial groups or gender groups cognize the world differently. So, you know, there's black truth and white truth. So we need, you know, black studies and there's man's truth and woman's truth. We need women's studies. You know, so they are poisoned with 200 or more years of, you know, of German philosophy and the legacy of Kant, Hegel, and Marx. And so it's horrible. And the politics of that, since, you know, society is all powerful, societies replace God, and, you know, society molds us into what we are, is ethically is altruism. We need to serve others. And politically is collectivism. We need to serve others in the macrocosm. We need to serve the state. So it's venomous. Is New York worse than California? I don't know. They may be equally bad. It's interesting that, you know, Americanism and the idea of individual rights survives in the more rural areas. And Texas has a lot of big cities in it, but still relative to New York and California, it's more rural. Arizona, more rural. But, you know, where people aren't going to college very often, and they're not poisoned by modernist philosophy. They tend to have more respect for individual rights and, you know, and the essence of what makes America special. And they tend to have more reverence for it. So I don't know if New York or California is worse. They're both very bad.
Yeah, I mean, if I can say something positive about New York and California, because I think the one thing that we miss is, I mean, they're real productive geniuses in both of those places in high concentrations. I mean,
yeah, sure.
As much as Wall Street is crony and all the problems, there's some amazing people in Wall Street who keep this country going through the proper allocation of capital. And there's Silicon Valley in California.
And Hollywood, too, does some good things, too.
Yeah, and Hollywood does some good things. And they're certainly productive. And so in spite of this horrific philosophy that both areas have, and Boston has the biotech industry and has, I mean, that's what is stunning to me about America is that in spite of all the bad, there's still these entrepreneurs and businessmen and inventors and stuff who still manage to do great work in spite of this horrific atmosphere that they have to live through. All right, Andrew, what are some of your modern day living heroes you admire today, whether artists, industrialists, thinkers, et cetera?
Living, can I include recent? Because, let me give you a mixed case of who I think is a hero. And that's Elon Musk, you know, who strikes me as crazy. And, you know, and he loves sucking the tit of government and, and taxpayers' money. And yet, I think SpaceX is a brilliant visionary company. He's gonna, we're gonna be an interplanetary species, right? We're gonna land men on Mars in 30 years. I mean, his R&D guys figured out how to land rockets on, on ocean-built platforms and reuse them, which is an enormous innovation. And it's amazing. It certainly makes, much less expensive space exploration. So I think, as crazy as he is and as much of a rent seeker as he is, to use the economist term, I think the good outweighs the bad. I think he's a brilliant visionary. I think Jeff Bezos, he may be a verbally abusive guy like Steve Jobs was, maybe, that's what I hear, but he's a brilliant entrepreneur. And I think Amazon is a brilliant company. I wouldn't be surprised if one day they make good on their promise, to deliver packages by drone, in urban areas, like the same day you order, that's just amazing.
One of the things I often complain about on this show is that a lot of people don't have a real problem separating productiveness from politics. So I know a lot of people who call themselves objectivists who rail against Jeff Bezos and about, I don't know, people in Silicon Valley because they're leftists, even though they're productive geniuses and they've made our lives so much better.
Yeah, Bill Gates, is a leftist, and there's a lot of things about him I disagree with, but we don't want to lose sight of the fact of what Bill Gates and Paul Allen and those guys did at Microsoft. I mean, they revolutionized the software industry, right? And to this day, there's 7 billion people in the world. How many of them are using Windows in their computers? Because it's user friendly, it's versatile, and it's inexpensive, and it's a great product. Yeah. Steve Jobs and Steve Wozniak, Steve Jobs is gone, unfortunately, but they revolutionized the computer industry. I think they're real heroes. Maurice Hillman, the great vaccinologist who nobody ever heard of, is a real hero. Ayn Rand is a towering hero in the field of sports. I thought, Michael Jordan was like a god for many years, and he was certainly one of my heroes. And by the way, sports heroes can be real because, the great story that Michael Jordan was cut from his high school basketball team is true. He's a great grudge holder. He still talks about it. He's still angry about it. But the thing about it is you don't get to be the GOAT, the greatest of all time,
yep,
in any field just by having tremendous ability in that field. Work ethic combined with tremendous ability. Michael Jordan's work ethic was legendary. And you could compare it to Ayn Rand. To me, she's the GOAT. She wrote the two greatest novels in world literature. She's a genius. She has that 1% inspiration that Thomas Edison spoke of, but the 99% perspiration, right? She said she rewrote every page of Atlas Shrugged at least 5 times. That's at least 5,000 pages she wrote. I mean, that's how you write the greatest novel in history. Be a genius and put in what the great Jerry Rice, great football player, called the sweat equity. You put in that kind of work ethic. So athletes can be, you know, legitimate heroes. And I think Michael Jordan to me is.
I don't know if you know that. Why was rocketry and other engineering feats invented by the Nazis, given their system was anti-mind?
What did they invent?
Rocketry.
Oh, rocketry.
Rockets.
Oh, yeah, rockets. Well, first of all, there's a couple of points about the Nazis. First of all, they came to power in Germany in 1933. Germany was already, you know, a very, very, very advanced country. It was never a free country in the sense that Britain was or the United States. But under Weimar, you know, Republic, it was certainly much freer. And even under the Hohenzollern dynasty, you know, and the Iron Chancellor Bismarck, it was much freer than under the Nazis. So they inherited Nazis inherited this very advanced culture. I mean, let's remember, Germany, whatever objections we have to certain characteristics of the Germans, they may be a trifle, you know, militaristic and aggressive sometimes, but it's one of the most advanced cultures in history. And the Nazis, you know, took that over. I mean, if Wernher von Braun and a lot of their scientists was born in the 1930s, and if National Socialism had lasted, if they weren't such fanatics, and it lasted, how many great scientists would have grown up under the Nazis? I don't know. There was that great movie, was it with James Stewart, Mortal Storm, maybe, you know, which really showed it, that there was this great scientist, German scientist, who's pointing out to the students, human blood is human blood. There's no basis for claiming that moral superiority is in the blood. But there's a number of the students belong to the Hitler Youth, and they're yelling at him, "You going against the Führer?" You know, yeah. I mean, they have this dichotomy here, this truth as based in the evidence and reality, and this truth that complies with the Führer's commands. How advanced would Germany, you know, have been if the Nazis took over some garden variety country, like the communists took over Russia, which wasn't advanced? How advanced would they have been 30, 40, 50 years later, given that they probably would have killed off a lot of the scientists because they disagreed with the Führer? I don't think they would have been very advanced. So that, remember the scientists who would, first of all, Robert Goddard was an American, was the father of rocketry, and all these German scientists built on Goddard's work. But second of all, remember, Wernher von Braun and these guys were already adults by the time the Nazis came to power. They weren't educated under the Nazis. So I think that's an important point.
Somebody says they like Charles Lindbergh, even though he was a fallen hero. Do you have an opinion?
Well, you know, let's go back to Aristotle. Yeah, Aristotle was very careful in his reasoning. And we can say Lindbergh was a hero in respect to you know, his solo flight across the Atlantic in 1927 was a tremendous achievement, you know, of aviation prowess and courage. So he's a hero in that respect. To the extent that he was a Nazi sympathizer or, you know, a Nazi supporter, he's certainly not a hero. So I would view Lindbergh in the same ilk as Thomas Jefferson. I would say he's a morally flawed hero. I can't get away from the fact that his transatlantic solo flight was an enormously heroic achievement.
Good. I think we've gone over an hour. This was great. I enjoyed
it. This is fun. Yes, yeah, it's fun. Bro.
Absolutely. This is great. We have to do it again sometime.
Absolutely. You mind if I briefly plug my Patreon account?
Not at all. Not at all. Go for it.
Yeah, thanks. I mean, you know, my daughter's going to college next year. We got to pay good money for our kids to be brainwashed and to be communists in college, right? So if you go on patreon.com, you want to, you know, if you, let's put it this way. We're egoists. We don't ask for sacrifices. If you find my work of value, you know, contribute. One college kid put in like $5 a month. I was touched by that because he's a college kid.
That's
great. You know? Yeah, and if you got 1,000 people put in $5 a month, that's, you know, $5,000 a month. I can, let me tell you, here's the bad news. The students today, they're not educated. They're not ready for college level work. Yeah. My time is best spent writing, not teaching. And so, you know, that's Patreon account can help me do this. So anybody, anything you could contribute that you think my work supports your values, I appreciate it very much.
So it's Patreon with your name?
It's just, you know.
Andrew Bernstein?
You have a Patreon account, right? Go to patreon.com and then just And then, because you know, you can find my page. Well, you could link to it on my website, andrewbernstein.net. Andrewbernstein.net. You can get my, you can link to my Patreon page. Thank you, guys.
Thank you, Andrew. Don't forget, guys, the book is called Heroes, Legends, Champions: Why Heroism Matters. You can get it on Amazon, where you can get everything. And stay healthy, stay safe. Look forward to seeing you in person soon, Andy.
Yeah, thanks, Yaron. You take care, buddy.
Bye, guys.
Bye. Bye-bye.